Anyone recognize this? Anyone? Anyone? Yes, it is in fact the venerable Atari Punk Console, or as Forrest Mims called it, the stepped tone generator. It makes use of a pair of 555 timers. There's one over there, one over there. This one is in a stable multivibrator mode, aka a free-running oscillator, with this knob here adjusting the frequency of it. And this one is set up as a monostable, aka a one-shot, and that one-shot is being triggered by the A-stable multivibrator over there. They are running at very different frequencies, and it is causing the two of them to sort of interfere with each other and beat against each other. So when you adjust one or the other, you hear that kind of ramping, and then the stepping that's happening over here, which is why I guess Forrest Mims called it a step tone generator. So this one is, let me just turn that off because it gets annoying after a while unless you're doing something musical with it. So this one over here, the monostable, is essentially adjusting the duty cycle of what's coming out and also the frequency at the same time. Whereas this one, you're just adjusting the frequency. And those two are sort of interfering with each other and bouncing off each other. This one is causing this guy to reset and trigger itself. But since they're running at different frequencies, they sometimes collide with each other as you're adjusting them. And that's why you hear those steps, even though it is a smooth adjustment on the potentiometer. Let me just turn the volume down a little bit. So even though you're doing a smooth adjustment here, or a smooth adjustment over here, it's going through those steps. Let's go and quickly look at the schematic and just see what we can learn about this guy. So here it is in the Forrest Mims book. He's using a 556, which is just two 55s in the same package. The pinouts, there's 14 pins instead of two 8-pin chips, so the pinouts got to be different. But it is functionally the same thing. Over on this side, pin 5 is the output. Pin 1, 2, and 1, 2, 6, and 4 are the A-stable multivibrator, and there's the capacitor. So as you're adjusting this pot here, it is adjusting the charge-discharge time of, actually, I guess it's adjusting the charge time of this capacitor, and the 1K is the discharge resistor. And then pin 5 goes out to pin 8, which is acting as an input. In this case, it's the trigger pin of the second 555. For the second half, we have a 500K pot, or at least in the MIMS design, that controls the charge rate of this capacitor. And you notice that they are, one is 10 times the other one, so you're getting different frequencies. And then we have the output of the second 555. In a real 555, it would be pin 3, but the output of the second half is pin 9, just through a DC blocking capacitor, a speaker, and a pot to act as a volume control. And there is essentially what you're getting as you change the value of the resistance. The tones kind of step through, which we were sort of hearing, right? So this isn't exactly using the same values as the MIMS circuit because I don't have the right values in stock. I know, you'd think a component hoarder like me would have the right parts, but whatever. Those are 50K pots, so I'm just going to flip in some 100Ks, which should, based on what we know about 555s, that should change the charge-discharge ratio, and it should change the tones. Still getting that stepping, though. It's just a lot more difficult to adjust. But with the higher resistance, we can get lower frequencies because, of course, that slows down the charging of the capacitors, right? That makes sense, doesn't it? Sure. And if we wanted to get even crazier, because I don't have the right resistors, and just add another 100K in there, and you see that drops the frequency even more. And changes the range that we're playing in. So that is reasonable enough, I suppose. Notice you're not seeing as many steps. And I'm sure they're still in there, but you're not noticing them as much. But in playing with this thing, there's another thing that I've noticed. You can actually feed them a control voltage, an external control voltage. And there's a couple of ways to do that, but the one that I have found that is most interesting, this is now, this pod is just being a voltage divider, is to feed into the actual CV input, which is pin 5 on a 555, and then we can feed an external voltage in, which allows you more adjustment. Independent of these ones, because again, these are just set up as just as a straight variable resistance. They're not a voltage divider. This one is acting as a voltage divider, so you could use any voltage source for that, which led me to do a little bit more searching, and that searching eventually landed me on this circuit. There are a bunch of variants on this one too. This is just the sort of nicest laid out one that I found. This one, the synth guys apparently call the Baby 8 sequencer. So we have our Atari Punk console over here. Same two 555s, same capacitors and resistors and everything else. That's all cool. There's the audio jack out, DC block cap and everything, just like I've got here. But then this part over here, another really familiar circuit, another 555. And the good old 4017, which is just a decade counter. Each clock pulse from the 555 triggers it to go to the next output, and the next output, and the next output high. And then those outputs, in this case, are going to an LED just to, you know, indicate being an LED, but also to these 10 pots and some steering diodes. They appear to be using silicon diodes, but I suspect that if you use Schottky diodes, which I happen to have, that I do have, you'll get a lower voltage loss. So let me just slam this together quickly and come right back to ya. So this is even easier than I thought, because I already had a 555 and 4017 set up on a breadboard from a couple of years ago. I just keep it off to the side because I like it. Anyway, so I've added these 10K pots in voltage divider setup, and these 10 Schottky diodes all summing together onto this one output wire here. Save that one for later. And yeah, so that's basically taking the voltage that goes to these LEDs and stripping it off and running it through these voltage dividers. So basically, the voltage that's coming to these diodes is, well, somewhere between VCC and ground, minus the 0.3-ish volts here, coming out onto this one. And I have also taken the liberty of adjusting these pots to all different values. So, we take that output and put it to our CV input here, and we take a ground over to here, 5 volts over to here. We should be getting something. Why are we not getting anything? Oh, right, ground. That's some kind of ugly noises at some of those steps. We can fine-tune it. By adjusting this guy. And again, this guy is adjusting the pulse width. We can also adjust the overall pitch of the thing. And we can, of course, make it go faster or slower. If we want to go much faster, we can replace the capacitor over here. Whoa! And of course, each one of these can be adjusted as well, but being as how they're 10 turns, they're kind of a pain in the butt to adjust, so I'm not going to do that right now. Hush. So that is a lot of fun. And I'm going to put a link down in the description to an electronic musician that I've watched now and again, who has played with this kind of stuff several times. So I'd like you to check that out just to see what an actual musician can do with one of these Atari Punk consoles. I think just for fun, I'm going to disconnect the sequencer though and just go back to this guy on his own. And I'm going to connect up the scope and take just a look at the waveforms coming out of this thing. Just for fun. Okay, so here is just the first oscillator. You see it's just a pulse, a little negative going pulse every once in a while. And if I adjust the frequency, you can see that the frequency changes. And if I turn the volume up, you can hear the stepping on the output. Now we're listening to the output, but that first oscillator, you can see the frequency is just changing smoothly as I wind it, right? And then I turn the second channel on the scope on. I'll pull that guy down a little bit. There is the other channel doing that. And that second channel is the output of the second 555. So if I adjust it, you can see it's... its duty cycle changing. And I apologize that it doesn't synchronize very well on the screen, but so that pulsing right there, that's just the two frequencies beating against each other because they're so close. If I adjust it again, then it starts going all out of whack again, and you get all these oddball things. So you can see there is the width of the pulse on the output from the monostable, and there is the A stable that's not changing until I go in and adjust its frequency. And so as the two frequencies sort of collide with each other, you get all these different weirdnesses. I think that's pretty darn cool. And then if we add the control voltage back in, you see it going all over the place. It's just, can I slow this guy down? Well, it's just as fast as that one goes. Okay, where'd my capacitor go? I lost my capacitor. There it is. Let's just add him back in parallel over here, which slows it way down. I can speed it back up again a little bit. You can see things changing. And in this case, this is the frequency that we're messing with, only the frequency of the A stable. But since the monostable is staying the same, as this frequency changes, then what's happening when they interfere with each other changes. I could probably, I haven't tried this yet, let's put that on the control voltage input of the second 555. That's interesting. And then you can see the frequency is staying the same, but it's just the pulse width on the output that's changing. Oh yeah, as you may notice, I changed the battery power supply for this thing just because I was getting some weird ground loops between the scope and this power supply, so that just cleaned it up a little bit. I mean, it's still an interesting kind of noisy noise, but it can be musical, as you can hear. And as I said, I'm going to link down in the description to one or more musicians who actually use this thing to make music that sounds musical because they have musical skills, and I kind of don't, at least not with this synth stuff anyways. Well, anyway, I hope that was a fun little exploration for me, and I hope you found it interesting as well. Please, as I said, go and visit those links down below, because I think you'll find it entertaining or amusing. Anyway, questions or comments down below as usual. I'll talk to you later.